Well, greetings, folk, tonight. It's good to have you. And I'm really pleased to be here tonight. So let me just turn this around. I just feel a bit crazy mood tonight. So here's my dog impressions. Hope you like them. Sometimes I end up in the doghouse if I'm a bit silly and Kerry doesn't like it too much. And I do end up in the doghouse. But anyway, Anyway, I've got a bit of a tale tonight to tell. So I guess I can look like a dog telling tales. I just put that little bit of singing on to begin with, because I always like to some sort of kind of introduction in case people are not quite ready for what's happening. Anyway, that's what it's all about. I remember growing up when I was a child, going to church, singing those old hymns. And you know, man, I'm glad some of the old hymns we don't sing anymore. But I also do love it when some of the modern churches take on the old hymn and just ramp it up a bit. It's beautiful. And a lot of the old hymns have incredible words and good theology. Some of the hymns have terrible words and bad theology, but the good ones are good. And I'm sure if you're getting at my age, you're getting a bit nostalgic and you might be thinking of some of the old songs that you heard as you were growing up in your mind. So that's what, you know, church used to be like many years ago. But what a different kind of church we have now. And look at us tonight, we're having church and we're on the internet and this is going all around the world and I'm being silly. So, I mean, you know, how much change has happened in church life. So it's amazing. Anyway, I want to get rid of this crazy face. Let me look and go back to normal. Looking. Here we go. Oh yes, there we go. Oh, it still looks a bit crazy. The light's a bit strange. That's okay. It's a nice light, isn't it? It's kind of a heavenly light tonight. Oh, that's different. Okay, well, greetings. And I trust you're in for a good night tonight as we continue in my house on a Sunday night. And I hope you enjoy what we're doing and encouraged and blessed by it. So tonight's sermon, it's an interesting one. I have preached this before, but I couldn't find it when I was looking for all my sermon notes. On my old sermons, I actually couldn't find this sermon, but I remembered a bit of it and I looked around a bit and I've got a sermon that is not the same sermon as I preached many, many years ago, so it's a little bit fresher, which is good. It's good for you guys and good for me as well. So I don't know why that light's going up and down like that. It's going woo. Anyway, it's cool. So let me get my notes and we will begin seriously, okay? Where are my notes? Well, you'll have to forgive me. Sometimes I'm just in a crazy mood. But I'm happy to be here. I'll have to say that because, you know, if I wasn't happy, it'd be pretty dumb if I just got up and with a salt, you know, sad face. Don't want to be here. I am happy to be here. And it's a pleasure and it's a joy to have your attention for this moment and to be able to preach God's word and to bring something that might encourage us all. So tonight I'm going to look at this interesting story about the widow with the bottles of olive oil. And it's quite an interesting story. So let me first start with a small illustration. Oh, and what I've entitled this this sermon, When You're at the End of Your Rope. So that's the sermon title tonight, When You're at the End of Your Rope. And I'm sure all of us get there at times and feel that at times that we're at the end of our rope. So, as an introduction, there's this thing. James Dobson tells this story, the true story, of a little toddler named Frankie. He was a handful, to say the least. Probably a bit like me when I was growing up. I was indeed a handful. One day, he pulled a chair over to the front window of his house, carefully placed it inside the drapes. He was standing there, staring out at the world when his mother came looking for him. She spied his little white legs protruding beneath the drapes and quietly slipped in behind him to see what he was doing. I imagine this kid was always up to mischief and in trouble, so she was probably curious to see what her little son was doing at this time. She got there just to hear him say in a very somber tones, "I've got to get out of here. I've got to get out of here." Yeah, I'm sure all of us have felt those same thoughts. We might have looked out of a window ourselves or looked out of a situation or, you know, But we've certainly, I'm sure, uttered these words, you know, I've got to get out of here. Sometimes when I'm in work, I'm singing that song, get me out of here, you know. And I don't always want to be at work when I'm supposed to be at work. And I wish I could get out of there sometimes. I'm sure all of us have gone through these feelings. You know, do you ever feel trapped? Have you ever felt like you're at the end of your rope? And just when you reach this point, you know, the realist would say, oh, just tie a knot and hang on. The pessimist would say, you might as well let go. It's only going to get worse. And the optimist might say, just tie another knot and keep on climbing. Each has its own merits, but in reality, what can you do? Some of you are in this very place today. You're at the end of your rope. And when you're at the end of your rope, there's a long drop beneath you, and sometimes you do not know what to do. And it's a terrible place when you feel that way, that you're at the end of yourself and you can't go on and continue on the same anymore. But the good thing about not wanting to continue doing the same means there's opportunity for something different to take place. And I remember talking to a counsellor once, and he said, well, it's great that you're talking to me as a counsellor, because that means you want something to be different. And that's true. You know, even when we're at the end of a rope and we don't want things to continue the same, it gives us possibility for something to change and something to be different. What do you do when you're facing problems with your children that you can't solve? What do you do when your marriage is on the rocks and the crashing waves of hopelessness are unrelenting? What do you do when there are problems at work and it seems there's no way out? What do you do when you have too much month left at the end of your money? You know, when you're only halfway through the month, but you've ran out of money and you've got another, you know, 2 weeks to go before you can get to the next paycheck or whatever it comes in, you know, what do you do? What do you do when you follow the loved one's body to the graveyard? That's a sad one, isn't it? You know, when we lose someone, when someone dies for whatever reason, and we go to the graveside and we say our final goodbyes. It's a very difficult. What do you do when your heart is broken and your dreams are shattered and your hopes have been dashed into bits on the cruel rocks of reality? Well, these are stern things tonight, aren't they? They're nearly kind of depressing things if you sort of get too heavy involved in all of this. But you know, there are times when we feel this way, when we get to that end point. What do you do when you are walking through a spiritual wasteland and there seems to be no way out? See, all these things that I've spoken are how we can feel when we get to that point of being at the end of our rope, the end of our tether. Is there any other things? I don't know what other things you could say. And I don't think anyone but God has the answers to these hard questions. You know, I think it's very difficult. And sometimes we can't find answers sometimes to the difficult situations we face. Only all we can do is hold on to God. So sometimes, you know, you need to let go of the rope and hold on to God, because the rope's going to fail anyway, but God won't fail. And sometimes we're looking for answers that we're not going to receive, and perhaps not receive now, maybe later. But we've got to hold on to God and trust Him to help us through the difficulties that we face and the challenges that we seem to be addressing in our lives at the time. Now, there's an interesting scripture that we're going to look at later about this lady, a poor widow woman who was at the end of her rope. She was in the pits. She was depressed. She was upset. She didn't know what to do or where to turn. She was in pain. She was in poverty. But she did know one thing in this story. She did know one thing. She knew she could turn to the Lord. And when she did, God came through in a big way. So that's so important, isn't it? You know, that when we don't know where to turn, when we don't know what to do, look to God. It's that simple. When you're at the end of yourself, then find God. Because there's no end to God. He's there for all of us in such a powerful, wonderful way. And, you know, in this scripture tonight, which we're going to read, and then I'm going to try and preach from without any notes, really, this passage, it teaches us the glorious truth that God has a plan for our problems. And these verses that we're looking at show us how God took care of this widow woman and how he can take care of us. This passage lets us know that when we reach the end of the rope, when we come to a place where we can't go forward and we can't go backward and we don't know what to do, then there is help and there is hope. You see, the one thing about Christian life is there's always hope. No matter what difficulty we're in, no matter what struggles we're going through in a Christian life, there is always hope because God is always with us. God says he will never leave us. He'll never fail us. He's always going to be there. And we can trust in him absolutely. What a great thing we have. What a great blessing we have as Christians in having God as our hope. He's the anchor of our soul. He's the anchor that keeps us still in those stormy times. He's the one with the safety net. He's the one that we can depend on. And so we're going to look at some of these scriptures tonight and just discuss some ideas. I don't know how this is going to go, where we're going to go. Well, I've got a bit of an idea, but who knows what it's going to turn out like. I don't know. And if I don't know, I'm sure no one else will know at all. So let me read you the scripture to start with. That's a good place to start, is reading the Word of God. This is from 2 Kings chapter 4. And verses 1 to 7. It's a well-known story. If you've been to Sunday school, you've probably heard it a million times. Anyway, this is the story. It's a true story. When I say story, I don't mean it like a fairy tale or fantasy. It's a true, actual, factual account. The wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elisha, Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that he revered the Lord. But now his creditors is coming to take my two boys as slaves. Elisha replied to her, How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house? Your servant has nothing there at all, she said, except a small jar of olive oil. Elisha said, Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side. She left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. When all the jars were full, she said to her son, Bring me another one. But he replied, There is not a jar left. Then the oil stopped flowing. She went and told the man of God, and he said, Go and sell the oil. Pay your debts, you and your sons can live on what is left. What a remarkable story, what a remarkable account in such a few words do we read of this incredible life struggling situation that was taking place to this dear widow lady. We don't even get to know her name. We don't really get to know much of the story of her life. Up to this point, or even after this point, we don't really hear much about this lady. But in these seven verses, we get this glimpse into a person that was in a desperate situation. Put yourself in this lady's shoes for one moment. Put yourself in the picture. Start to think for what you would be feeling and what she would be feeling like at this time in this desperate situation. You see, it says here, her husband was dead. Her husband had died, and the creditors were coming to take her boys away as slaves. So not only was she a widow, not only had her husband died, and she was obviously still perhaps mourning and going through that whole process of dealing with the death and the funeral and all those things. And then on top of that, she's got no money. They're in poverty, and there's people knocking on her door wanting some money because they'd obviously had some bills. They'd obviously had some finances before that they needed to now pay back. And the creditors were coming to take the two boys as slaves. Now, this wasn't an unusual situation because often in these times, people were sold as slaves to pay back a debt. It was not an uncommon thing, it was a common thing. If you got into debt, then the only way to sometimes solve that debt and pay off your debtors was to be sold as a slave, and then the debt was paid for through the sale of the person. And so here was this lady, and she was She was in a very bad situation. She was at the end of her rope. Believe me, you can't make this sugar-coated in any way. If you do, then you've got no heart. You've got no feelings. You're callous. Think about this for a moment. Her husband had died, and she had two sons. We don't know her age, but we can imagine she's been married for quite a while. What a terrible shock for her to have a husband die. I mean, you know, me and Kerry, I talk about it often. We've been married how many years? 42? 42 years. I was telling Moses in Belarus the other day. Now, men normally die before the ladies do. That's normal, you know. And can you imagine, you know, we've been living together for so long, me and Kerry. When I die, if I die before her, it's going to be devastating. Not because I'm so wonderful. It's just the way it is. She'll be devastated. I think if she died before me, I'd be devastated too. But I'm not sure if I'd be as devastated as she would be. Because I think, you know, sometimes I've got a bit more strength to get on with life. I don't know. Just imagining. But, you know, when somebody dies that you love and you've lived with for many years and they're your husband and your wife, for them to die, it's a tremendous blow. It's a shock. It's horrible. And not only that, this put her in a terrible situation. She obviously was not good in the financial situation because, you know, most people when they die, they have a little bit of a will. They have some life insurance, and sometimes some people are well insured, and the widows get good money. But in this situation, they were left in poverty with bills to pay that they could not pay. It was impossible for them to pay these bills. They had no money whatsoever, and there was no social security back then, and you couldn't go to a church and ask for special offerings. Yet they were really in a bad place, and she was at the end of her rope. Not only was she dealing with all this stress and all this stuff going on in her life, she was thinking that she might lose her two boys. Now, I'm sure, you know, mums love their children. And I'm sure mums love boys, you know, they just love their boys. And she would have loved these boys. And to think that not only has she lost her husband, but now she was in the process of perhaps losing her sons, that she would be totally alone by herself without any possibility of looking after herself in any way, really finding money for herself to pay bills and to live, and the loss of losing her sons on top of the loss of losing her husband would have been amazingly painful for her to think about. And she would have been at the end of her rope, at the bottom of the pit. I'm sure she was not in this incredible happy mood at this time. As we look at this scripture, she was obviously in a very sad place. But she did one thing she did, which is smart. You see, I said before that when we get to that place where we feel we're at the end, we need to cry out to God. And this woman did that, and by crying out to the man of God or the prophet of God. You see, the prophets represented God in that time. So here she is basically crying out to the prophet or crying out to God. And she cried out to Elisha, "Your servant, my husband, is dead." Now that's interesting, isn't it? Because this wasn't just anybody dying, any sort of man dying. This man was actually part of this group of prophets. He was actually involved in Elisha's group of prophets. And it says here, "Your servant, my husband, is dead." He had served with Elisha in some way. He'd been involved with Elisha's ministry for some way and some time. And she says here, "You know that he revered the Lord." So obviously this man was upright and well thought of, and she reminded Elisha who he was. You know, like, remember George, he used to be one of your mates, and he used to serve you and help you and be with you and travel with you, and he was a good man and he had a good heart for God. And she's reminding Elisha of this fact. But she's doing it in a positive way. This is what I think is interesting. She's not coming like, "You rotten rat bags, you know, you've done, you know, my husband's dead, what do you care?" You know, isn't it funny sometimes when people go into some serious problems, they blame God for it, and instead of crying out for help, they cry out against. And this woman could have been bitter and twisted. Oh, my husband served for years in the church and now he's dead and I'm in poverty and my sons are going to be sold into slavery. What's the use of this Christianity? She could have responded in negativity, in hurtfulness, and all resentments and all those sort of things. But we don't see that in this scripture as it portrays this story. And you know, like I'm pulling a lot out of this and making it into a big story, but I think I'm keeping to the facts as much as possible. Anyway, I'm sure it's there if you look hard enough. Okay, so she came with a right attitude towards Elisha. I feel she came with the right attitude. The reason being is Elisha's reply to her. Elisha replied to her, "How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house?" "Your servant has nothing there at all," she said, "except a small jar of olive oil." Now, I said before that when we get to the end of our ropes, we need to ask God for help. We need to get to God and say, "God, I'm at the end. I can't go down. I can't go up. I can't go left. I can't go right. I'm in a bad place. Stuff's happening. I've got no control over. You know, you've got to help me, God. Please help me." I love what Elijah said. He said, "How can I help you? How can I help you?" That's why I know that this woman didn't go to Elisha ranting and raving and judging and shouting insults, because he received her and says, "Well, how can I help? How can I help? What can I do?" He probably had fond memories of this man, this husband who had died. He'd probably met this woman before and the children before. And he's like, "Wow, you know, what can I do? I want to help here, you know. You've come to the right place because, you know, I want to help. It's good to go to the right place to get help." You know, she's come to the right place. And so she tells him what's going on. She tells him the story. You see, when we come to God, we let God know what's going on. Tell God what's going on. Explain to him. I mean, God knows, but it's good for us to just to explain to God how we're feeling and what we're thinking and speak it out, pray it out to God and let you know, talk it out with God. Tell him. The Bible says you have not because you ask not. That's crazy, isn't it? You know, we lose out on life so much because we don't ask God for it. We don't ask God for help. We try to do it ourselves. We try to struggle through some situations when we could have just gone to God and laid it out to God and then said, "God, this is the situation and I really need some help." And then you'd be amazed at what could take place and what would happen. And this lady, she says, you know, she tells him what's going on and he says, "Well, what do you have in your house?" It's a very unusual question, but it's what he said. And she says, "All I've got is a small jar of olive oil. Except a small jar of olive oil." And it's interesting because, you know, a small jar of olive oil is actually oftentimes was reserved and kept aside special for anointing. It wasn't a big jug of oil that you cook your chips in. It wasn't the normal olive oil that was used for cooking or for lamps or whatever they used it for. To me, this speaks of a small, special kind of jar that would have been used for anointing oil. And it's interesting, isn't it? It's like it was sacred to begin with. There was something special about this oil to begin with. And she says, "But all I've got is this oil." Elisha said, "Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few." My third point. These are points, by the way. My first point was when you're at the end of your rope. My second point was ask God for help. My third point is, you don't have to do it alone. We don't have to do this journey alone. We don't have to go through struggles of life alone. We don't have to go through the downs of life or the victories in life alone. We're called as a community to share with our friends and loved ones and fellow Christians in the body of Christ. We're not called to this journey as individuals. We're called together collectively as the family of God, as the body of God. And Elisha says, "Go and ask your neighbors for empty jars." You don't have to do it alone. You don't have to struggle alone. You can actually reach out to other people. And in today's modern world, we've got many places we can go to for help. And oftentimes, it's just good to ask people around us to, to think of us, to pray for us, to care for us, to look after us if they can, to help us. You know, sometimes people have pride, and it's the pride that stops them from reaching out and asking for help. Many people have such incredible, difficult problems, but they will not ask for help because of pride. But this woman, you know, she wasn't like that. You don't have to do it alone, and you don't have to do it alone. If you're going through situations today, you don't have to do it alone. Actually, it's silly to do it alone. It's better to, you know, if you've got problems, share them. Give them away, actually. Give them to somebody else. That's a better idea. But, you know, we're called to be in community. We're being in community. And I'm sure you've got family and loved ones and Christian brothers and sisters who could gather around and bring you comfort and strength and encouragement, even perhaps some help physically, spiritually, and financially. There's ways to do it. So you don't have to be alone. Okay, then he said to her, then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons, pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side. She left him and shut the doors behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her and she kept pouring. Now, I love this thing here. I love this next one, two, three scriptures that are here. And I've called this, her faith produced the miracle. So here she is. She's at the end of the rope. She asks God for help. She doesn't do it alone. But her faith, it was her faith that produced the miracle, that produced the answer to the problems that she was facing. Isn't that incredible? I mean, I find this amazing because so often we want the prophet, or we want God, or we want the pastor, we want someone else to do all the work for us, to help us in our times of need, to provide in every way, and just come in and change the whole situation. And yet in this story, in this account, it was actually her faith. It was her faith that produced a miracle. Elisha didn't go in and speak hallelujahs over all the empty jars and suddenly they became full. Now, Elisha was God's prophet and he had a powerful ministry and he could have done something like that. I think one time he raised the dead when he fell onto the body and it came to life. You know, he was a man of the anointing power of the Holy Spirit and he could have performed a miracle. He could have just gone in there and, you know, prayed and laid his hands on the jars and they could have all been filled with oil. But he wanted her to understand this was her journey and her faith was going to be vital for this journey. And the incredible thing was, it was through her faith that she got the help and answer that she needed. How amazing would have that been for her? Because not only would it help with that immediate situation, but that faith that she developed and strengthened would have lived in her life for years and years and years as she testified and talked about how God had provided for her. It would have done more than one thing. It would have done more than just solve that problem for that time. It would have escalated into years ahead of faithfulness. And I love that idea. Anyway, so here, her faith produced the miracle. Her faith produced the miracle. Why do I say this? Because the prophet said to her, then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons and pour oil into all the jars. And as each is filled, put it to one side. Now, can you imagine for one moment, she's just heard the prophet say this to her. She's been sitting there and the prophet's telling her what to do next. She's already been quite embarrassed because she's already had to, you know, go out around the neighbours and send her sons out to, you know, the guy across the road and the neighbour next door and, you know, and up the road and on the hill. She's already been scouting around the whole neighbourhood and asking for jars, and the people are probably wondering, this, she's gone cuckoo, you know, this is a crazy woman, you know. She's not only is she, you know, she's losing her husband and her children are being sold into slavery, and now she's gone cuckoo, and her brain's gone, and she's running around asking for empty jars. I mean, she couldn't have explained to the neighbours what she was doing. Oh, I've got to have some empty jars. Why? I haven't got a clue why. I don't know why. You know, can you imagine somebody knocking on your door, I need a jar? Oh yeah, sure, you can have a jar. What do you need it for? I've got no idea. See, the prophet didn't tell her what was going to happen. She had no idea what was going to happen. She didn't even know that she was going to go inside the house with the jars at the point. She was just told to go and get them. It was the next instruction that was given to her that told her what to do. And then, okay, she's being told to go inside the house and shut the doors. So it was all private. Nobody could see. Only her and her sons were in that building. And the prophet said to her, pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side. Could you imagine that? You've been told to go into the house. You've got this little jar of oil, this big, okay? It's just a few teaspoons of oil, and the prophet's telling you to go into your house, and there could be 100 jars by now, all on the tables and chairs and on the floor, and there's jars everywhere. I mean, man, if you're going to go out and get jars, you don't want to go and get two. You might as well get as many possible as you can. I would go and, try and find 1,000 jars, And anyway, she walks into this room. The room is totally filled with big jars, all kinds of jars, all shapes and sizes. And she's got this little tiny jar of oil. And she goes, wow, how's this going to work? How is this going to work? How is this tiny little bit of oil going to fill these jars? How is it possible? But she obeyed. She obeyed. She obeyed what the prophet had said. Can you imagine the kind of faith that you would need to actually go up to the first jug and start to pour? And you think, well, man, the bottom's not even going to be covered over with this amount of oil. She could have just said, no, it's a stupid idea. The prophet's mad, it's not going to work. It's stupid. This is not how I'm going to solve my problems. What's going on? Let's give it away. But she didn't. Something in her had faith and belief in what the prophet had said. She believed the prophet and what he told her. And he told her to pour the oil into the jars and they would be filled. So with the words of the prophet ringing in her ears, she's gone into the room and gone, well, this is what the prophet said. And I've got faith in the prophet. I know the prophet. He knew my husband. And I'm going to do what he tells me to do. And there was such a strong faith that was in her heart at that time. And she begins to pour the oil from that tiny little tube into that first jar that was probably, 10-liter jar or something. Could you imagine for one moment? I can. Perhaps you can too. Can you imagine for one moment? The boys are standing around, okay? They're ready to be sold off as slaves. They're probably not so happy at this time. They're probably thinking their mum is completely nuts and the prophet is just as stupid. They're not in a happy place at all, and now they've gone out and had to get jars around from the neighborhood, and it's all embarrassing. When teenagers have to go and do stuff they don't want to do, it's embarrassing for them, and they've had to do all this stuff and have come back into the house, and now they're on this crazy idea that we can pour out of this small little tiny jar enough oil to fill not even one of these bigger containers. But can you imagine, I love this, can you imagine what it must have been like as she shakingly takes that little jar, she shakes, shaking, because she's a little bit trembly, and she starts to pour it into that first container, and as she pours, she keeps pouring. And it's like the more she pours, and the level of the oil, it's going up, and up, and up, and up, and up and up and up and up to the top of the jar. And she's going, oh man, this is incredible. She's probably starting to do a little jig and say a hallelujah, and she's looking at her little jar of oil, and it's the same. There's the same amount of oil in that little jar. It hasn't changed at all. And she's looking with nearly disbelief and bewilderment and wonderment and everything else meant, looking at that jar, the first jar that's topped to the brim with oil. How impossible. One jar filled from this tiny little bit of oil. And yet the oil also remains there. It hasn't gone away. There's still the same amount of oil within that small container. And yet there is that first jar of oil, just full to the very top. And she is like, wow. And then she wanders over to the next jar, and I tell you what, there's a bit more excitement. And the boys are getting a bit more, oh, I'm going to watch this, see how this magic trick works. There must be some trick in this. And, she starts to pour into the second container, and in the second container fill to the brim, and wow, you're two, we got two bottles. Man, we got two bottles out of this tiny drop of oil. Isn't this amazing? And she's looking at a tiny little bottle of oil, and it's still the same measurement of oil inside that bottle. It's not changed at all. And now she's got two bottles of oil filled to the brim, gallons and gallons of oil filled to the brim. And she's looking around at the room now, and looking at, wow, there's probably 100, 150 bottles in the room. Wow, her mind is starting to spin. She's starting to feel pretty good, pretty crazy as well. Excitement and bewilderment and enjoyment all at once. But she kept pouring. She didn't stop at two. She didn't stop at three. She didn't stop at four. Come on, boys. Come on, watch this one. We're up to bottle number 20. Come on, watch what's happening. And the boys are, they're getting their iPhones out and they're taking TikTok video of the oil being poured into the 20th bottle because they can't believe it and no one else will believe it. And they're filming it and the bottle's getting fuller and fuller and her little bottle stays the same. It doesn't change at all. And 20 bottles, 40 bottles, 50 bottles. She's just filling up and filling up and filling up and filling up. And I tell you what, the atmosphere in that house was changing. There was something taking place in that house that was electric. It was explosive. She was starting to see the possibility of getting out of the trouble that she was in. She was starting to think, "May, I'm not going to have to sell my sons into slavery. Something's taking place here that's going to be my deliverer. There's stuff going on right in front of my face. It's the answer to my prayers. It's the answer to the problem that I'm facing right now. I'm experiencing the answer, and it's coming from a miracle. It's coming from God himself. He's giving me the answer to my problems." Wow, what an amazing thing. And she's just, by the time they get to nearly three quarters of the pots, they will be just laughing hysterically and hugging and kissing and loving. And can you imagine? You wouldn't just be there stony faced going, "Pour, pour, 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 next, pour, pour, pour." You would be getting so excited. I'm sure they'd be hooing and haring and maybe it's not true. I don't know what the Jewish people do, but I'm sure something took place. I'm sure something took place with those three people in that room as this miracle took place. It says here in verse 6, when all the jars were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another one." But he replied, "There's not a jar left. We have filled every single container that we could lay our hands on. We've filled them all to the brim with this incredible oil, and your little tiny oil bottle has not changed. You have the same oil in there as you started with. Not less, not more, exactly the same." And when they finished the very last bottle, the oil stopped. The oil stopped. When she filled every bottle, when she couldn't put it anywhere else, anything else would be wasted. Anything else could not be used, could not be contained, would just be wasted. The oil stopped. Isn't God so good? He gives us enough and more than enough, but not for waste. Not for waste. He never blesses us so we waste our blessings. He never gives us so much that we get caught up into materialism and money, lust of money. He gives us enough to do the job. And when we've got enough that God wants us to have, it stops. That's a wonderful thing to understand. So her faith produced the miracle. Oh, my voice is going croaky. I'm getting too excited tonight. Her faith produced the miracle. So, points. When you're at the end of your rope, what do you do? Ask God for help. That's what you do. You don't have to do it alone. You don't have to do it alone. But sometimes the key to your problems and your situation is going to be your faith. And God wants you to strengthen and grow your faith to believe God can do all things. See, we say all these things in church. We read the scriptures about how God can help us and God can do miracles and God will do this and God will do that. But sometimes when the crunch comes and we get into a difficult place, our faith seems to disappear and we start to wonder if God actually can. And sometimes we need to strengthen our faith and tell ourselves, yes, it's possible. God can do all things. God can do all things. God can help us in every situation. God can. And we need to strengthen our faith, and sometimes we have to exercise our faith, and sometimes we have to do something practical to exercise our faith. And that's what this lady did here. She practically did something by taking that shaky little first step to fill the first container. There was a physical action that she took place that produced this faith in our heart. Sometimes, when we have people who have a healing ministry and they pray for someone, maybe somebody with a broken arm, after they've prayed for them, say, swing your arm around, you bend your arm, you know, do something you couldn't do before. What are they trying to do? They're trying to get that person not only to, you know, in their mind and in their thinking spirit have the faith, but put it into physical action and see a miracle take place. And sometimes it's not till the person does something physical that the miracle takes place. I get confused sometimes, I read things, but somebody said to somebody, I think it was Jesus, said to this person, reach out your hand. And as he reached out, his miracle came. You see, sometimes we have to put our faith into action. And if we ever get into the book of James, you'll hear a lot about that. You know, there's a lot of miracles in the Bible where they had to do something, an action, a doing thing, a physical doing thing that activated the faith to produce a miracle. And this lady did this. So we have to learn how to activate our faith and put our faith into something that's doing to see the miracle that we need for our situation when we get to that place where we're at the end of our rope. Okay, verse 7. She went and told the man of God. So, you see, the prophet didn't even hang around. He just told her to go and do it. He wasn't doubting. He wasn't worried that it wouldn't work. He wasn't peeping through the curtains to make sure, you know, everything was going okay. He just told her what to do and had got away. And so she chased after him. She found him. She went to him and she said, you know, this is what happened. What you said is all true. You know, I've got all this oil. I've got bottles and bottles and bottles of oil. And he said to her, go and sell the oil and pay your debts. And so here she was, you know, she was in a place at the end of a rope. Her husband had died. She was in a terrible situation, and up grieving and a heartbroken. And then her sons were going to be taken away off into slavery. And now here is this answer to this need that she had, and produced by her faith and a miraculous work of God. And there was enough oil to pay her debts. So her sons would be free to live with her. So she would not lose her family. She would not lose her sons that she loved so much, you know. And she needed sons for company in her old age. She needed someone to look after her, to help her. So what a great thing. She was able to keep her sons and pay off the debt. She was debt free. How many people would like to be debt free? Amazing situation. She was debt free. But not only was she debt free, get this. Not only was she debt free, but wait, there's more. You've seen that out on TV, isn't it? You know, buy to this TV tonight and we will give you a second TV. And if you are the first 50 callers, we'll give you something more. Well, there's more in this story as well. Not only was she debt free, but there was more. Well, debt free was incredible, wasn't it? To be able to pay the debt to save her sons from slavery was an incredible, most amazing story, the most biggest miracle. All the neighborhood would hear. All of the area where she lived would have heard of this miracle. It would travel like a hot fire, like a forest fire. It would go out of control, you know. But there was more. There was more than this. What more was there? It says, go, sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your sons can live on what's left. There was enough to pay her debts, and it was enough to live on for the future. Wow, amazing, 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 amazing. God not only took her out of this terrible, desperate situation and paid for her finances that she needed, but he gave her more to live on. Isn't that the goodness of God? That God not only supplies to us what we need, but he's so generous in giving us extra. He's a lavish wonderful God that delights in, you know, giving gifts into our lives, and he's not stingy, doesn't hold back. He's a God of the overflow. He's the one that, you know, makes our cup runneth over, you know. He doesn't hold back with his giving into our lives and helping us and providing for us. What an incredible story. Wow. Well, I'm nearly at the end. I'm just looking at what I've written before. Wow. It says, this passage teaches us the glorious truth that God has a plan for our problems. And that, isn't that true? You see, right through that whole situation, you can see the problem being solved step by step. There was a step-by-step plan for her to find the answer to her problems. And you know, God has a plan for all of us to help us through every problem that we might face. That when we reach that point where life is too much, when we're only just holding on for the, you know, till our strength runs out, when we feel like we're just at the end of ourselves, God has a plan for us. God has a plan of salvation. I mean, God always has a plan of salvation. He saw the world lost and he sent his son. God always has a plan. There's a plan in God's heart for us. There's a good plan for our lives, and there's a plan to help us through the hard times. God doesn't want us to go through these difficult times. God wants us to live in victory and be overcomers and to be blessed and have an abundant life so that we can be a blessing to others. But when we do go through difficult times, let us know that we can trust in God, we can turn to God, we can tell God what the situation is, and then we can start to believe that God is going to do something for us in a miraculous way. And miracles take all sorts of forms and shapes. I've learned that in life. You know, miracles come, sometimes they look like normal natural things, but they're not, they're miracles. You know, sometimes we dismiss some of the blessings of God because we don't recognize they are from God. We just think it's normal. No, they're not normal at all. The verse shows us that God took care of the widow. Not only to save her sons and give her enough money to pay her debt, but to give her something for the future. I love that. God's not about just dealing with the present, but he puts something into our lives for the future. God has a plan for us, a care plan. We talk about care plans nowadays, and you know, we've got an elderly mother-in-law that we're looking after, Kerry's mum, and yeah, we have a care plan for her, you know. God has a care plan for you that will take you for as long as you live. You know, as long as you live, God has a care plan. He's the best person you can ever have to be your, you know, blue care nurse or your, you know, whatever you need. God has a care plan for you. This passage clearly shows us that when we reach the end of a rope, there is help and hope. Help and hope. I mean, surely this lady has shown us in this story, you know, you can't get too much lower than where she was. She really was in a difficult place, in a tremendously heartbreaking place. I'm sure emotionally she was right at the end of her emotions, you know, and so fragile and so distraught and overwhelmed and sad and sorry and all of those things. But she went through the right channels, you know. She realized what she needed to do, and she went in the right direction. When we get into those places ourselves, you know, we need to turn to God, our Creator God, who loves us and cares for us and wants to help us in our life situation. Well, that's it. I've finished tonight. Now, that's nothing like the last sermon I preached on that topic. I can't remember how many years ago it was that I actually preached that sermon, but it's nothing like that at all. It was absolutely nothing. It's amazing. I love that tonight. I really enjoyed it, and I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope my imagination wasn't too crazy for you. If you're a deep theologian and have studied the scriptures and read every commentary on this verse, then please forgive me if I've put too much of my thoughts into it or my imagination. Some of the things might never have happened that I talked about, but you can start to understand, and we need to understand what was going on, the emotions and the situations that were developing in this story. So I think I've not over padded it. I've stuck a little bit to the truth, I hope. And I hope it's been a blessing, because that's all I'm doing this for, because I want to be a blessing to you. I've enjoyed it tonight, and I hope, because I've enjoyed it, I hope you've enjoyed it. And I hope that we're going to learn something. That's the most important thing, to learn. What can we learn? We'll go back to the points and look at the points again. And that's what we can learn. The example of this story is what we can learn for ourselves to apply it to our own lives. So if you are going through that hard time, and indeed we all will, and we all can do, and in the future maybe, you know, because we don't know what's going on in this world anymore. God knows and we don't know. But because God knows, then he has the upper hand and he has the plan. You know, if we knew things were going to go belly up, we could make plans for, but we don't know. But God knows, so he makes the plans for us. We just need to turn to him in times of trouble and cast our cares on him and have faith in him and understand that he loves and cares for us and wants to provide in every way for us. God does not want to damage us, hurt us, disappoint us, break us. That is not what God wants to do. There is stuff that happens in our life that causes suffering and problems and situations, and God can use those to make us different people, but God doesn't do it to us. Life does it to us, and this world, this fallen world which we live in, does it to us. Anyway, I'm going off on a tangent there, aren't I? I'm actually finished early tonight, which is a big round of applause. The first time in 1.5 years that I've actually finished a sermon early. So you have now, 5 minutes of your life that I'm not taking up. So be blessed. Anyway, thank you for watching. Be blessed, and I will see you next week. Bye.